Quite recently, I went on a trip back to South Africa, where I grew up for most of my double-digit years, but also I think all through high school. And even though it was only a small visit, I do think I'm gonna go back there permanently, maybe in a couple of years. And if you've read the title, you probably know why. I think South Africa really needs a Strong Towns movement. But for context, what exactly is a Strong Towns movement? Well, we have to discuss what they're trying to answer first. For the second half of the last century, American cities have been committing quite a blunder. They've made themselves car dependent, dedicating a lot of the area to build inefficient suburbs, or what you would call urban sprawl, instead of the traditional development patterns which have been tested upon thousands and thousands of years. The consequences that this had was very immense. In the coming videos we'll go over in detail, but right now I'm gonna talk about three main ones. Well, economically. Economically, these suburbs are very expensive and usually are a burden on cities and individuals. The website Urban 3 shows it quite clearly. You can actually click on the various cities and it will show you where they are solvent, where they are not. And it's just clear that wherever they are insolvent, it's definitely a good looking suburb, as opposed to a rundown looking city center where the money is actually made.
Hiding the bigger picture of who's subsidizing who. Because these gray sections are the poorer areas, while these red areas are significantly wealthier. So here's a fun quiz. Which of these two neighborhoods is subsidizing the other? Number one or number two? Yeah, it's the first one that's subsidizing the second. The poorest people in Lafayette are consistently subsidizing wealthy suburbanites. But I don't want to pick on Lafayette here. As I said at the beginning, there's nothing particularly unique about Lafayette, and these results are typical for most.
The reason why it's that way in America is because of segregation. And South Africa does have a very well-known part of its history dedicated to segregation, so I wouldn't be surprised if that's why South African cities also look
this way. Class and racial segregation. In the early days of automobiles in the US, city planners would build low bridges around poorer communities who were predominantly African American, because these communities could not afford cars. Instead, they were forced to take the bus, which could not fit under these bridges and therefore kept them out of areas with higher paying jobs and better schools.
And socially, this design is very alienating for a community. Unlike traditional development patterns where streets, or any other public space, was a good place to socialize, to hang out with other people, but within a car-centric community, most public space is only accessible in tiny pods, which is not very good for interaction. Lastly, and probably the most obvious, is traffic. Roads, no matter how much you widen them, can only support so much traffic at a given time. Also, due to the laws of induced demand, the more lanes you add, the more traffic you end up with. We'll talk about this in the future in more depth. With all these problems, especially traffic, that's the one that you deal with on a daily basis, so that's the one that's really the one you feel most attachment to solving. The urban sprawl pattern, as it is known, received quite a lot of pushback in recent years, mainly led by the Strong Towns movement, funded by Charles Marone, or else known as Chuck. He used to be an engineer working on designing more and more suburbs, but he noticed that they were making cities financially insolvent, and as a result, advocated for new urbanism. I have a series where I summarize his first book, but I highly recommend that you actually read it yourself. You'll find a lot of information, and it's a very enjoyable read. Now let's get back to Cape Town. I noticed while I was going through those days where I could only focus on learning about trains and urbanism, that many of the problems that he pointed out with how American cities are laid out would also apply to Cape Town. The strict zoning laws, the unreliable public transit, Strode's, all of it could be applied to Cape Town just as easily. And I saw it firsthand. I didn't think about it as much, but when I came back to Cape Town, I made sure to look out for it, and I saw a lot of these problems. Before we continue, I should point out there are a couple of things that Cape Town suburbs do better than American suburbs. One is they do have more greenery, which is why I was actually able to make a couple of friends, because I just randomly bumped into people in the park. But in America, it's very difficult to get to a park, because a lot of it is just suburban hell. That being said, it's much better in a place that's not car dependent, because you have much bigger areas to socialize and much better areas to accidentally make a lifelong friend. And secondly, another thing Cape Town suburbs do a little better is that they're not entirely car dependent. You can go, if you're in a suburb and you want to get to a shop or something, you can go on a walk, and it's not a nightmare as it is in many American suburbs. But the problem is that driving is still the only option that really makes sense, which is why many people drive, because the design motivates it. I remember once I went to a church that was in service, the Good Shepherd Catholic Church opposite the high school where I grew up, and it was filled outside. The amount of space that cars took up, the entire corner was taken up by cars. And that's within a suburb. If you're talking about going outside the suburb to a different place, you will almost always take a car, because it doesn't make much sense to use anything else, because the infrastructure just isn't there. Cycling, the public transit, it's almost non-existent. Now, how do we solve this? How do we make sure that we are not car dependent and avoid all the bloody problems? Well, one, as I mentioned before, is traditional development. Second is good cyclic infrastructure. And third is public transit. Let's talk about these in more detail right now. When we talk about traditional development, we're talking about more mixed use, as opposed to the zoning laws that decrease the likelihood of your destinations being anywhere near you. It's why when we go to grocery shop or anything, we have to really plan when we're going, instead of, say, in European cities where you can just go outside, walk down the street, and just pick up some groceries. Or in some cases, it's even in your building.
Where you can buy fresh food. In the Netherlands, most people prefer to make small trips to buy food for today or the next few days, rather than large weekly or fortnightly shopping trips by car. This by itself isn't that unusual. Most cities I've been to in Europe and Asia have grocery stores and markets dotted throughout the city. What's interesting about the Netherlands is how optimized everything is to make your grocery shopping trip as fast as possible. Shops are not set back behind a sea of parking, so it's easy to stop in if you're walking by. In fact, many grocery stores do not have any car parking at all, and it's common to see them in pedestrianized areas accessible only by walking or cycling. Of course, bicycle parking is always provided right up front, making it possible.
And speaking of streets, another thing we have to point out is that streets and roads are actually very different from one another. Roads are for mobility. They're meant to get people around and not really provide access to anything. Streets, on the other hand, are meant to provide access, but they're not meant to move people around too quickly, because people moving quickly, it doesn't fit in well with people doing stuff. And as such, we have to get rid of what are called strodes, which is a mixture of the two, and it does both terribly.
This is a road. It is a high-speed connection between two places. Because of the high speeds involved, there are several safety features. The lanes are wide and forgiving, so that vehicles do not bump into each other. The road is as straight as possible, and when curves are necessary, they're designed to be gentle, making it easy to drive along. The area next to the road, called the clear zone, is free of any obstacles that could be hit, just in case a vehicle runs off the road. The signs are very large, designed to be read from a distance at high speeds. And entrances and exits are few and far between, because the road is designed to keep vehicles at a high speed for as long as possible, to minimize travel times. Roads are important. We need roads.
Though I personally prefer my roads to have rails.
This is a street. It is a complex environment where life in the city happens. Buildings are placed right next to the sidewalk to be easily accessible by people walking, and it gives a sense of space, almost like an outdoor room. This is a place that feels comfortable to be in, so you find people here. There are many entrances and exits to and from the street, and there may also be street parking for vehicles and deliveries. This is an environment meant for slow speeds, because this is a destination, not a thoroughfare. High-speed traffic is not compatible with lots of human activity, so vehicle speeds are reduced. Everything on the street is at a human scale. It's designed to be inviting, encouraging people to walk, to window shop, or to just sit and watch the world go by. The street is designed to get the most value out of the space available. Streets are very important, and we definitely need streets. A strode, on the other hand, is neither of these things.
It's a street that is designed like a road, and in doing so, it fails at being good at either one. The strode fails at being a street. There are many driveways to businesses and homes like you find on the street, but mixed with multiple highway-sized lanes. This mixes high speeds with many points of conflict. Watch out for this white car turning, and this cyclist. Are there any cars coming out of these driveways?
Unlike a street, roads are hostile to people outside of a car. There are lots of motor vehicles and speeds are high, so walking or cycling feels uncomfortable and dangerous. There are long distances between places, and there are often large parking lots that need to be crossed before getting anywhere. And it's basically impossible to cross this road, except by walking to a traffic signal and waiting. The signs are large and meant to be read while driving, which feels really out of scale if you're walking there. And often trees have been removed from the clear zone, making the environment even more uninviting if you're not in a car.
But the stroke fails at being a road, too. The lanes are wide and there are a lot of them. You're surrounded by asphalt, but you can't actually get anywhere quickly like you can with a road. There are cars constantly changing lanes and going in and out of the stroke, slowing down traffic and introducing many points of conflict that require drivers to constantly slow down to avoid a collision. Traffic volumes can be quite high on strokes because there are no viable alternatives to driving. Distances are too far to walk and it's too unsafe to cycle, and since public transit gets stuck in traffic anyway, only the poor and the desperate will take the bus. So everyone drives. Strokes are really expensive. Because strokes are built to a highway standard, their lanes are very wide and there are never less than four lanes. Plus, there's normally extra space for shoulders and clear zones at the side of the road, too. Because strokes try to be streets, there are many entrances and exits, so many turning lanes are required. But because of the high speeds, turning lanes are much longer than on a street, taking up even more space. And as traffic increases even more, due to traffic entering and exiting the strode, the city will install another traffic signal for $750,000. All of this means that a strode is much bigger than a road that would carry the same amount of traffic, and significantly larger than a street that would have the same number of businesses.
I'll leave a link to a video that goes in depth on these issues, but needless to say, it sucks. Another thing is highways. In many American cities, and unfortunately Cape Town, the highway goes right through the city, which is a terrible idea. Highways typically go around big urban areas, not through them. And lastly, speaking of greenery, I mentioned that South African suburbs do this a bit better, or at least Cape Town suburbs do. If we're talking about strict urban planning, we have to remember the 3-30-300 rule. At least 3 trees when you look out your window. An average of 30% of the area should be covered by trees so that your suburb doesn't become a frying pan during summers. And you should be maximum 300 meters away from the nearest green space. Especially with the way heat waves are going, you need something to cool down. And the trees, I think, provide a great opportunity. Next thing we have to discuss is cycling. See, cycling is a very useful commuting technique when it's done properly. And unlike cars, cycling do give you the ability to communicate and also providing fresh air, and it also provides the necessary speed so that it doesn't feel too tedious. And combined with that is that if you have a group of cyclists, they can actually accelerate at the same time and control the speeds better, which is why they don't really end up in traffic, unlike cars. When we talk about good cycling infrastructure, we're not just talking about a cycling lane here and there. What we're actually talking about is fully grade separated roads that allow cyclists to go where they want to without needing to interact with cars that are going like 40 kilometers an hour and also not disrupting foot traffic.
The biggest difference is that while other cities put bicycle trails where they're easy to build, such as along a former rail line or through a park, these bicycle roads are part of a wider network and are explicitly built to connect to destinations you'd actually want to go to, such as a sports arena, a park, a school, a swimming pool, or a hospital. So I find myself using them regularly because they're the fastest and most convenient way to get to where I need to be. Bicycle roads are designed to the highest standard wherever possible. That means they're at least 2 meters wide in each direction, with smooth red asphalt, and without any barriers or sharp turns.
The best example of this would be the Netherlands. And again, this guy has a nice video that goes over what the infrastructure looks like over there. And lastly, public transportation. The heart of the backbone of transportation in any city should be the public transport network. There's a lot to go over, so I won't go over all of it, but I need to say a couple of things. Cape Town is easily far behind when it comes to where public transit should be in such a city. For comparison, here's Athens, a city that has a similar metro population, and one that's actually considered behind many European cities. Just like Cape Town, they do have a commuter rail and a bus network, but additionally, they also have a tram network and a metro network. I think it's fair to say that Cape Town is far behind, not having a single tram or metro. It used to, but unfortunately, they're gone now. I'll make another video where I discuss the differences between these systems. What is a tram, what is a metro, and what is light rail? But right now, that would be getting ahead of ourselves. Another thing to consider is the approach to designing public transit. A lot of the time, you design it only for the people who don't own cars. That way, it seems more like a charity, as opposed to designing a transit in such a way that even if someone owns a car, they will choose to use public transit. A good example of this would be a place like Tokyo, where only 12% of people need to drive to work. Everybody else just cycles or walks or takes public transport. There's a bit of a cliche among urbanists that we like to quote a lot. A developed country is not a place where the poor have cars. It's where the rich use public transportation. Conclusion. Alright, over the coming months and years, I will make videos on various urban topics that South Africans need to understand. But in the meantime, I think somebody in the country has to start an urbanist movement. When I get back there in a couple of years, I will try to help and I will see what's going on. But for now, the responsibility is up to you. So if you have a group of friends you see on a daily basis, firstly, let me know what that's like. I kind of miss that. And also, even if you're not up to it now, well, tough luck, buddy, because when I get back, you better be ready.